Ja, this is experiment number two deals with border plots. For this, we can offer two experiments, two experiment places to gain phase analyzers, which are capable to measure a big number of border plot points and store them into an internal RAM and then send these values to a PC so that you can store these values as files, as ASCII text files, and take it at home. So at any point, you can analyze your measure data later on your PC. Of course, this analyze should be done also during lab. Here we have three different transfer blocks. So this experiment contains three parts. But at the same time, we connect a scope to have a clear view on the sinusoidal signals. The gain phase analyzer produces sinusoidal outputs, so we can check if there is overshoot or undershoots or nonlinear effects or anything else. And the sinusoidal generator output is connected to the input of the transfer block, which is also grounded, and at the same time connected to the one of the two measurement inputs for the border plot. And the device measures magnitude and phase values between sinusoidal signals at these both inputs. And with this information and changing frequency, we can scan over a definite range and measure round about 100 points and get nice, very accurate border plot measurement values. Okay, here you see the open loop measurement idea. Problem in this case is if the generator output is set to a constant amplitude, and this is what we want to do. We change the frequency, not the amplitude. Then it could happen if the gain is very large that at some ranges the output amplitude is so large that the operational amplifier limitations cut the sinusoidal signals at a special value, and then of course with this nonlinear effect the border plot measurement is destroyed. So there is a trick which can avoid exactly this limitation of the output. In a second principle display here, you can see what we can do as a trick. The transfer block here is the same as here. There's our device under test, yeah, DUT, device under test. Now what we do is we connect a negative feedback with a P block to the input. So we make a closed loop system. Now we can say, okay, this closing, this feedback changes the behavior of clear from this input to this output. Now we have a closed loop behavior, which is different to the open loop behavior. But, and that is a trick, the generator output should not be, or is in this case not the same as my V1 input, because we just connect now the generator output to the input. This is a desired value of this simple loop. So now we define with this control system the output amplitude. And if this controller is working is working stable, then we have a very good control of the amplitude of the output with this desired value. So this avoids limitations if the transfer block has high gains. This is the case for the both two device under test we have in this experiment. Why can now the gain phase analyzer measure the open loop transfer function of this block? Because the V1 input is connected to the input of my device under test, and the V2 input is connected to the output of the device under test. So the gain phase analyzer calculates the ratio of this to this signal, the phase shift from this to this signal. This is the open loop behavior of the transfer block, independent of the situation that we now define the output amplitude with my controller and not the input amplitude. So this is a very good trick to get open loop functions without limitation problems, which we have in the first case. Okay, so that is for the understanding of the next circuit. It's important to know how this works. The gain phase analyzer has three plugs. One is a sinusoidal output plug, and then we have two input plugs. And now you see here my circuit, which is in a black box, in the transparency block. Here you see this device under test you want to investigate. This is a PIDT1 circuit. This circuit can be analyzed and investigated with equations you can find in the workbook. This is an inverting amplifier, which makes a feedback to this subtractor. This is, of course, this is an adder, but together with this inverter, now we get here the difference between this signal and the output sinusoidal signal. So this is the control difference, and this is a P controller with just gain one connected to the input of my device under test. Do you know, okay, if you have here a negative and feedback with a capacitor in series with a resistor, the DC gain is infinity, or as large as the DC gain of this operational amplifier, so very large. So if the frequency is very small, of course, then we get an open loop measurement very quickly over limitations of the sinusoidal signal. So we must do this in a closed loop system. Here you see our measurement range is 5 decades from 0.1 Hz to 10 kHz. What you should do at home, that is a preparation, please don't forget it. You should draw the Bode plot of this device under test, this PIDT1 circuit. Draw please this Bode plot manually on millimeter paper. Please not a printout of my tools. Please not a printout with MATLAB or any other tool, because we want to have millimeter paper. Because the reason is, for this millimeter paper design, we want to make points of your measurement into your preparation to see if theory and your preparation fits together. And for this we need millimeter paper. Otherwise, the drawing is not so easy. Some hints for this millimeter paper is now coming with experiment number two. Bode plot for preparation. Preparation can be found in Moodle course. Yeah, in the lab file folder, you see in task 2 for the Bode plot, we have two PDFs which contains millimeter paper. And for the first part, for the PID, you need this 5-decade PDF. If you open it, you get this printout. You see here, that is 1 decade, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 decades. And here some millimeters, some centimeter, millimeter scaling. So for your Bode plot, you need the decision, where is my horizontal axis, where is the scaling. I give you some hints for the scaling. The the PIDT1 Bode plot needs 5 decades. F scaling, magnitude scaling is 1 centimeter is 10 dB. The range goes from, now we get this type of curve. Now we have here, this is 0 dB, this is 40 dB. The cross point at 0.1 is 43 dB, and this is K in dB. This is 0 dB. So the scaling should in that way that the zero axis is not important. You should have this sizing, and I want to have now a log frequency axis. That is the difference to all border plots we have seen in our lecture. Why f not omega? Because we want to make measurement points into your hand drawing, and for this the gain phase analyzer throws out the frequency in hertz, in f. And if you have an omega axis, then for any frequency point you have to multiply your value reading from the device times 2 pi and then look for the correct point. It can be done, but it's a little bit more comfortable to have the frequency axis. Note that then this is the corner frequency, is not 1 over Tn, that is omega. F you get by dividing omega by 2 pi. So this is 1 over Tn divided by 2 pi. This is 1 over Tv divided by 2 pi. And this is then the step steps in dB, ST in dB. Now, and the starting point here at 0.1 Hz, so 0.1 Hz is 43 dB. I want to have your magnitude curve, and of course, I want to have the phase curve. The phase curve of a PIDT1 looks like this, starting from minus 90, going up, and then ending at zero. So you need a scaling down to minus 90, here's zero, and that is, I think, 50 or so. So I think 10 degree per centimeter could be a good solution. And I want to see this on this millimeter paper. And then, you know, connect the device with the gain phase analyzer, start measurement, select frequency scaling. We show you how you can operate with the gain phase analyzer. The setting is rather simple. If you see this one time, you can do this for yourself for the other parts of this experiment. Yeah. So that's a experiment. Second experiment. First part. Second point two is the DT2 circuit. If you go into our lab paper, then you can see all things are the same, but this device under test now is exchanged into a DT2, similar to experiment one. Here we have a PIDT1 measurement and a DT2 measurement. At this time, we need, of course, now the head drawn border plot of this device with the given component values. You can use a DT2 page workbook to calculate the transfer function. Yeah, so we need the transfer function values. The transfer function of a DT2 looks like this, Kp divided by 1 plus 2d divided by omega naught by times p plus 1 divided by omega naught squared p squared. That is a normalized DT2 function, Kd omega naught from the workbook. So I want to see these values on your preparation paper. And you should now draw the transfer function border plot. So f omega magnitude is, and if we calculate the magnitude value of this, we get very simple, that is k times omega divided by 1 plus, very simple, the denominator is exactly the same as the denominator of a PT2. The difference of a PT2 and a DT2 is just this p in the numerator. So this omega in the numerator is the difference to a PT2. So we can say, can say the magnitude curve is nothing else than omega times f omega of pt2. And phase of dt2 is nothing else than a p in the numerator just at 90 degree phase value plus phase of the pt2. And the phase of the pt2 and the magnitude of the pt2, sorry, magnitude indicators forgotten, see workbook, pt, wo sind sie, das müsste jetzt da sein, dt2 block is followed by the pidt1 block, and then next part is the pt2 block here. Look on the page, that was over here, 22, this is the magnitude of the pt2, this is the phase of the pt2. Yeah, see page 22 in the workbook. Page 22, very easy, just shift this curve with 90 degrees in the positive direction, and here draw this curve. Some indicators, the dt2 is on which page in the workbook? dt2, da ist er. Here you see the dt2 asymptotical construction. There are two asymptotical curves. This cross point with a 0 dB line is 1 over k. This cross point is k times omega naught squared. The corner here is directly at omega naught, and then there is a peak defined by the damping factor. I show you some resulting elements here. Your Bode plot should look very similar to, again, node log f not log omega. This is the asymptotical construction. This should be at 112 hertz. If you have done all things right, this is 16 dB roundabout, and there is a peak value of 32 dB. I want to see this type of curve, and I want to see in your calculation some points around this peak value, because we don't know how sharp is this peak. Is this curve, or is this curve? To differentiate between this and that curve, we need some points around the omega naught frequency, very near to f0, if this is 112 hertz, at least at 100 hertz, I want to have a point, and maybe at 120, yeah? Then you can find out how sharp is this peak. Okay, phase curve is the same. Phase curve of PT2 should look like this, log F. The phase curve goes from positive 90, very steep, to negative 90, plus 90, 0, minus 90, and the 0 point is F0. So, make a good preparation for this phase curve, then we have a good quick measurement comparison with your theory. That is part 2 of the second experiment. Part 3 is a digital filter. If you have never seen or working with digital filters, then this is a good introduction of some properties of a digital filter. In the paper, you see Yeah, note that the frequency range here for the DT2 is the 1 Hz to 10 kHz, 4 decades. You need the 4 decade border plot, also available in Moodle course. Here are some hints how to read in the border plot values. That is the picture here of our gain phase analyzer. There is a serial connection, and here this tool program has a module with which you can read in the values via serial line into the PC, and then you can work with these values and make nice printouts and so on. So during lab you make a manual point by point comparison, and of course you get during lab a comfortable comparison between all 100 measurement points you made with this device. Okay, part three of second experiment is the following. The digital filter is running on a simple PC. You see, this is a rather old picture. Today this looks a little bit different, but the software is very similar. There is an ADC card built in this PC. This ADC card can be used as a digital filter, not for very high sampling frequencies caused by Windows. Of course, the sampling rate for this digital filter is 1 millisecond. So with 1 millisecond, of course, we can only have filters with for very low frequencies. Doesn't matter, the principles are always the same. The software has to be switched to the ADC card. We want to use the first time in this lab two different ADC cards. One is a built-in national instrument card, which can convert very quickly within some microseconds. And then connect again scope to see the real time curves, and connect then the gain phase analyzer. Here you see in this case we make an open loop measurement, very simple, caused by the fact that our filter here is only a simple low pass filter which has a maximum gain of 1. So in saturation here, limitation cannot occur. So what we can do is now switch on the correct module for the digital filter, run it, measure the border plot, and then look into the curves, and then we will give you a possibility to calculate the theoretical border plot, and then you can read in the measured data and draw a new curve with the measured border plot and compare then theory with measurement and find some reasons for the differences. Yeah, that is just a good way to discuss sampling problems like aliasing and digital filter problems like delays. What you should do is you should convert a given analog low-pass filter, a Kauer low-pass filter fifth order, which I have found in a filter book. You should convert this analog filter into a digital one using my WinDF tool. And the task is that the corner frequency of the digital filter you measure depends on your group number. You have 6 persons, so your group number goes from 1 to 6. So the first student has 70 Hz corner, then the second is 30 Hz, and so on. So you have all different digital filters and get all different measurements. Yeah. How can the design be done? Very simple. The conversion of my analog filter, which is given as a file, as a ZK file, as a time constant file with given time constants of the analog filter version. You can read in this in my WinDF C# tool and then convert with a special frequency. I show you very quickly how to do this in this program. With this button, you can load a digital, an analog filter. So just click on this, load the given Kauer low pass filter, and then close this window. With this button, then you can convert any, and especially this digital analog filter, into a digital one. Here, what the only thing what you should do is you have to select a sampling time for this conversion. This sampling time you should calculate, and this depends on the desired corner frequency of your digital filter. I show you a way to calculate your special number here. If you type in this number, say OK, then the digital filter is available in this box. Then you see here 11 floating point values. And with a selected ADC card, you can activate the digital filter with this box, and then this runs with 1 millisecond. Very important. The design sampling time you have selected in this window, this is a design sampling time with which you design a digital filter, can be different to the runtime sampling time. This runtime sampling time should always be 1 millisecond. That is the fastest sampling time my program can be used in on a Windows system as a real-time filter. Yeah, 1 millisecond. If these are different, for example, we design with 0.1 second and play with 1 millisecond, then we run the filter 100 times faster than we design it. And this means that the complete filter curve is now 100 times shift to higher frequencies. So we can shift with this runtime sampling frequency any filter curve to any position we want to have. That is a big advantage of digital filters. And to define your design sampling time, we have just very simple go into this example. You should know that the Kauer low-pass filter has a corner frequency, very low corner frequency, of 0.159 Hz. If we want to have, for example, 1.59 Hz, 10 times larger sampling frequency, then we have to play 10 times faster than design. If we play with 1 millisecond, then we have to design with 10 milliseconds. You see, the ratio of the corner frequencies here you want to have defines the ratio of design time to runtime sampling frequency. This example helps to understand it. If you want to have 100 Hz corner frequency at 1 millisecond runtime, then we have to run this analog filter 628 times faster as we design it. So we design with 628 millisecond and run it with 1 millisecond. That's a very simple trick. So with this example, you easily can change this value to your desired value here and then calculate your desired sampling design time. Okay. If you have typed in this analog filter, then here are some screenshots what you have to do then. And if you have done this, switch to 1 millisecond and start. First, calculate the Bode plot. Here's a Bode plot calculator, and which draws a theoretical Bode plot curve. And then you make your experiment and read in your real Bode plot curve with starting with the National Instrument curve. And then I like to have a second measurement with a different ADC card. I'm not sure if you have time enough. I like to have it because this is nice. We have a self-built ADC card, which also can do the job within 1 millisecond, but the delay is much larger, and then you can see hardware defines delay. So I want to have this, but first do this with national card, and I want to have the delay, because within the system, the digital filter, there is a pure delay time block, and with this table you should find out this delay time value by looking to three radian frequency points. The display is here done in log omega scaling. Look for these 3 points, measure out of this curve the theoretical phase, your measured phase, difference of both values. Use this equation to convert this phase difference into a delay. It is a delay phase ratio of a delay time block. Then you get three delay values. They normally, theoretically, must be the same. If you make good measurements, these values is the same. But if there are small differences, I want to have the average delay. And then in the program, you can type in here in this box the delay value you have calculated, make a third curve, and then compare the third curve with your measurement. And if you have calculated correct phase value here, delay time value here, then the measured curve should be very exactly identical to the measured curve to this delayed phase curve. Finally, yeah, we want to explain how this delay comes from. We find out that the delay is mainly dominating by the sample and hold mechanism. Sample and hold mechanism has one part of the delay time, and the second part is the calculation time of my hardware, and this calculation time should be measured one times with an internal software measurement. These numbers in the software gives a delay time measurement with a stopwatch. If you have done this, you can also do this with hardware. This program has a second digital output plug, and here you can activate this impulse on channel 2, and then connect the scope, measure the impulse width, and this impulse width is very good indicator for the calculation time, because in my software I set this second output to 1 volt before I start calculation and set it back to 0 volt after calculation. So the period of this pulse indicates my sampling time, and the width of this pulse indicates the calculation time. Okay, then compare the delay of your phase difference to your pulse measurement, and yeah, maybe it's time enough. Then do the same with the second ADC card. Just connect it, run it, select it, run it, and add theoretical with measured curve, and measure also the new delay time. It will be much larger. The last step, you should do the following. You should have a constant sinusoidal input with this frequency points, and measure then the output signal. You will see this is a contradiction to Shannon theorem. You are now higher than half of the sampling frequency. Sampling frequency is 1000 hertz. Now we want to investigate what happens if we have aliasing. So I want to have here the period of the sinusoidal output signal, convert this with inversion to the frequency, and I want to have the ratio between this frequency and this frequency, or the rule which shows the behavior between input sinusoidal frequency and output sinusoidal frequency. And there is a very simple rule, and I want to show you how this works, and we want to discuss how this is produced, this ratio of input and output signal. And then This experiment is completed. I hope that you have a good preparation of border plot, because if you have no border plot with millimeter paper, you have to do this during lab, and this takes time. So please bring millimeter paper with your border plots, magnitude and phase curve of the first both circuits. So far, this experiment preparation information.